Let's move on now to Syria, where Syrian President Bashar al-Assad has agreed to a peace plan beginning on April 10th. That's the deadline for a UN-supervised ceasefire. That's said to include the withdrawal of soldiers and heavy weapons from cities and the delivery of humanitarian aid. Now, this, of course, will only work, however, if the rebels put down their weapons as well. And that might be difficult to do if the rebels get additional outside support. Over the weekend, several world leaders met in Istanbul, Turkey, to try to work out a plan to deal with Syria. And part of that plan involves sort of redefining or at least blurring the lines between lethal and non-lethal weapons that they hope to send into Syria for the rebels. And the United States, joined by dozens of Arab countries, have started to come up with a plan to pay some of the rebels' salaries and also to purchase and send in high-tech communications equipment to assist the rebels. Now, obviously, we know Russia and China blocked the UN Security Council proposal to intervene militarily, but the group that calls itself the Friends of Syria Coalition is still hoping to have more of an influence in as far as what happens inside Syria. So we want to take a closer look of all of this with Middle East analyst Ahmed Fati. Ahmed, what do you suppose this is about? Giving rebels a salary, sending the stuff in that may or may not be weapons?
As for the resolutions and the agreements reached in Istanbul during the Friends of Syria conference, it sends a little bit of mixed signals. The first mixing signal is that there is two main streams of ideas. One supporting arming the Syrian rebels, and the other one supporting assisting the Syrian rebels with non-lethal equipment. And that is led by the United States and the Western allies. The Saudi, Qatari, Kuwaiti initiative, whom they are going to be fitting the bill for paying the salaries for the Syrian rebels, on the first examining for it, it's a little bit positive, as it will provide an incentive for other Syrian soldiers to defect the Syrian army and join the free Syrian army, which is consisting of the rebel forces. On the U.S. side, the administration is reluctant to provide arming for the rebels until a proper vetting process will be taking place.
I think that's an important point. I think a lot of people wonder, as we did with the situation in Libya, a lot of people wonder, who are the rebels? And how do we figure that out when you start sending, even when we're not talking about weapons, when we're just talking about communication equipment, they're talking about sending night vision goggles in. How can it be determined that these are going to end up in the right people's hands?
This is the million-dollar question, Christine, and nobody have a concrete answer. The U.S. administration is obviously reluctant to proceed with arming the rebel in spite of pressures exerted on it domestically by the Republicans in the Senate to arm the rebels. Nobody wants to see the same mistakes done in Afghanistan in the 80s. Or with arming and assisting the Libyan rebels, as it turned out to be Islamist groups. And the administration is not going to fall into that trap, especially during an election year.
And Ahmed, I think it's really important to talk about sort of some other aspects here. Throughout the last year, this conflict in Syria, which has claimed the lives potentially at least of 9,000 people, it's been portrayed in sort of a simple manner. It's been sort of, you know, Assad, the evil dictator, and those rising up against him. But I think it's really important to point out that this has really become a sectarian conflict, a war between religious groups, with Sunni Muslims in Syria in the majority. But of course, President Assad is a Shiite. So many Sunnis now view this violence as a campaign to sort of squeeze them out of their homes and their villages. And I know the New York Times did a recent article about this last week. The writer Ann Barnard said this. She said, "They said they felt threatened as Sunnis, and several said that they saw the military give out rifles to residents of neighboring Alawite villages, members of the same heterodox Muslim sect as Mr. Assad, and that their neighbors then opened fire on them." So I guess I just want you to talk a little bit about, this is a little more complex than just those who support Assad and those who don't.
It is very complex, but other than the sectarian differences, it's ethnic differences. The Alawites are different than the Sunnis who have an Arabic background. Syria is a mosaic of ethnic groups. You have the Arabs, you have the Kurds, you have the Ashurian people, and you have the Sharkis who have Turkish roots. This all makes this melange makes it difficult to separate who's who. As far as the sectarian, I don't think that it is sectarian, but those who have started the opposition in Syria were predominantly belonging to the Muslim Brotherhood. The American administration is playing it very, very careful in Syria. They are with the principles of freedom, democracy, and human rights for the Syrian people, but they have their concerns that if, when and if they will supply weapons to the rebels, it might be used against them exactly as it happened in Afghanistan when they supported the Mujahideen group and history made its turn and we ended up with September 11. Nobody wants to see that anymore. As far as the Saudis, the rich oil states, paying salaries for the opposition, as I said earlier, it's going to present an incentive, which is supposed to present a situation, new situation on the ground. The Syrian foreign minister have sent to Kofi Annan yesterday a letter stating that they are ready to suspend all military activities and withdraw from the civilian centers by April 10th. Yet there is no trust and credibility for the Assad regime. We have to wait for this week to see where it's going to turn. As far as the sectarian conflict, partially it is true, but it is not the core of the conflict in Syria.
I think that's a really good point. There's a whole lot of different elements going on here, a lot of layers to peel back, and of course that is difficult for Western countries to really understand exactly what's going on when they talk about getting involved militarily or not. Middle East analyst Ahmed Fati, we do appreciate you joining us and giving your insight here.